Ladies and gentlemen, we're back with another UFC prospect watch. I'm really excited to get this one going. I feel like, you know, we're already at June, but it's, you know, a couple of fighters I really, really am excited to see fight again. And, you know, maybe a little biased, you know, when we really think about it, but you guys can also be the judge of that. You know, being in June already, I thought, you know, looking back at a few of the last months, even with March, Sean Brady, I don't think there's a guy getting more dark horse notoriety in terms of a title challenger. And even looking on Instagram, I feel like this is the one guy that especially younger fans are picking up and really starting to boost. And I'm excited to see what he accomplishes, you know, in 2021. And then a bit of a more questionable April, and I think that had more to do with the canceled bouts. We actually had Shamil Gamzatov sitting at number one, but that guy's had more canceled bouts in the last little bit than anyone I can really see. Hasn't fought since 2019. So once that fight got canceled, Alexander Romanov ended up number one, and obviously a little bit of a questionable fight there with Juan Espino, who I think had a great showing. And then coming into, you know, I felt like in May, we looked really good with Demir Ismagulov. I mean, that, even though he opened the fights in the prelims, I mean, he looked like a guy that's very much ready for the main card. And that's the beauty of doing these. You know, even when we look back, there's a few guys that we would love to mention on the rankings here, but this is all about getting some notoriety for some of the guys you might not know. You know, we got guys like Chase Hooper, Sumu Derji, Timur Valiev, and even Ramazan Emiev. You know, these are all guys that we would have either ranked already, or, you know, you might already know tons about. And so there's no real fun in covering those guys. But, you know, bringing up people that might be forgotten or some of the newer faces that are coming in is probably the best part of all of this. And so looking at the coming top 10, you can really start off with a fighter like Laura Procopio. You know, I think she had a phenomenal showing against Molly McCann, good boxer. And in that fight, it was a little surprising, right? I felt like people thought she was going to get absolutely dummied on the feet, but overall, I mean, she looked all right on the feet in terms of being able to cover her bases defensively and land some of her own shots. But, you know, as a complete MMA fighter, you know, we picked her in our pick 'em over on Instagram, but that was a very, very interesting fight to kind of judge her on, because I think she took on someone who's been able to see a lot of the, you know, tough competition in the UFC, and she looked really great. She's going to be taking on Casey O'Neill, who we're going to be getting into a little bit later, not too much later, but I'm really excited to see what Procopio can do, because looking at some of the ways she neutralized Molly McCann, it was probably my favorite part of her entire game plan, right? I thought that in terms of avoiding that boxing that everybody was preaching about that should be the biggest problem for her, I thought she dealt with it fairly well. You know, she lost her debut to Carol Rosa, and, you know, Carol Rosa, I got a bit of a crush on that girl, so, you know, keep that on the DL, but very respectable, right? I thought that that was one of those things where you look back at her UFC record, and even though she's so new to the sport and has a lot to, you know, improve, if you will, even in that one-on-one, she's done enough to kind of merit a lot of credibility, especially going into a fight with, you know, a standout like Casey O'Neill, who's kind of lit it up around the world coming into the UFC. And, you know, being able to go 2-1 against a fighter like Casey, it would be, you know, the real boost into maybe even seeing a top 10, top 15 type fighter. So I'm excited to see what she can do. The girl can take a punch. She pushes the pace, and that's what makes her so exciting. You know, you just don't see it in the package. Such a sweet looking girl, but, you know, she can really hang with them. And it's going to be that MMA all around ability that, you know, helped her beat Molly McCann, that's going to help her, you know, carry that over into the Casey O'Neill fight, because I think that's going to be a real tough fight for her, but it's also going to be a great test, right? We're going to flip the script right now and go right into number 9, who is Casey O'Neill. You know, we're going to go with her just because, especially ranking her above Procopio, it's really coming down to the showing that she did have, right? Not only do we know that she trains out of Extreme Couture and Tiger Muay Thai, but it really is, you know, just a culmination of such good striking and then the dominance on the ground, because everyone is saying that Shayna Dobson should have quite a bit of a advantage going into that fight on the ground and in the wrestling categories, because frankly, in the previous fight, she pulled off one of the biggest upsets of the year against Maria Agapova. But, you know, coming into this one, it looked like Casey O'Neill was a completely different breed of fighter, even in comparison to Agapova, when it comes to all around, you know, UFC, not only MMA skill, but just presence, right? I thought like that was a very irresponsible style of fight that Agapova fought. Whereas with Casey O'Neill, the way she picks her strikes, the way she actually can push the pace, get the fight up against the fence, she's the one that's controlling everything that's happening in there. And against a fighter like Dobson, who now is sitting at a 4-5 record, I still think that's such a you know, pat on the back for you in terms of a UFC debut, because she really made a name for herself on the Dana White looking for a fight coming out of the UAE, where we picked up a lot of great female fighters in the European and Middle Eastern scene. So coming in from that, you know, there's going to be doubts, but then she just proved that it's not just the striking that we need to fear, but the ground game is there. And she did it against someone who's actually been very successful in the fights that she's been able to win. So I really enjoyed that. The one thing about that fight that is really interesting is how inflated the stats for, you know, a fighter like Casey O'Neill looks, because, you know, she landed almost 7 takedowns in that fight at a clip of 66%. And that's a big deal to me. And she also maintained a 6-2 striking ratio. She was absolutely dominant. I mean, that's the part that kind of scares me for Procopio going into this fight. But at the same time, the way she's able to deal the damage, understand the game plans, and start to push forward and, you know, really be able to balance all of that pace, you know, going up against a good boxer. She really figured out what to do there to get that win. And in on the flip side, I think that she has what it takes to see if she can neutralize some of those really good areas that Casey O'Neill is showing off in, and maybe pull off a pretty big upset there. Because I would be a little surprised to see if Procopio was anything, you know, but a small, if not a pretty medium-sized underdog, because it's just really tough to see that being even money, if not, you know, in favor of Procopio. So let's see what happens with that one. I think it's gonna be a great fight. You know, at one point we had a 1-2 or a 5-6 type of showdown. Now we got the 9-10 showdown between the two ladies here. So best of luck to Lara and Casey, because I think that's gonna be a phenomenal fight and could get pretty violent if it gets to those, second and third rounds. So keep an eye out for that one. And going into number 8 now, we got Alexa Cameron. Now, this is a guy that was very exciting coming onto the scene, right? Big finisher, long, likes to throw big, powerful kicks. He's got the striking down too. And I think that, you know, Dana White Contender Series showing really propelled him into a pretty good showing against a guy like Justin Ledet, who's considered a veteran of the sport. And despite not getting the finish, you know, it was a good showing of his stand-up skills. Now, flip to his fight against William Knight. If there's one thing that everyone wants to give credit to William Knight for, is the ability to just not only be the smaller guy in most of his fights, but neutralize those types of long strikers. For him to be able to dictate exactly when to time those, you know, clinch moves and going into the fence and pushing it down to the ground. I mean, he completely neutralized Kamer by the second round. And the best part about a guy like William Knight is he can really do work on the ground. So as you're trying to get up, like, I mean, he's really putting it on you, and that's going to tire a big muscular guy like Kamer out, right? So Alexa has a lot to think about going into these next few fights. And I think that's where we see that veteran presence come into play, right? As opposed to going crazy and throwing these big strikes. I think now, after fighting a guy like William Knight, he's going to have the, you know, self-awareness to be like, well, I can't push too hard, make sure that timing is there to avoid any big takedowns. Now, in his next fight, he takes on a guy like Negu Marianu, who's a Romanian fighter and lost his debut to what I consider one of the goats of the sport, Saferbek Safarov. So I think that's going to be one where he can at least start showing off his striking again. I mean, if I'm Nick, I'm definitely looking to take this fight, you know, pretty much in close quarters, clinch type of work against the fence and to the ground, and test him again in those areas. But I think Kamer is going to really be able to show off some of that striking in this one. And like I said, he was a big finisher going into that Dana White Contender Series fight, came out with a big win there. And I think that that's kind of the one thing we've noticed that he has to work on, right? Just to kind of keep it on the feet, you know, that defensive wrestling that all these big fighters pretty much learn just to keep the fight standing is another area, you know, maybe you can hop on board with Kevin Holland and get those things worked out. But that's where we're going to see this next fight. How good is he at avoiding those areas of the game if Nick is smart enough to take it there? But if it's a striking battle, expect excitement. And I think Cameron's going to be very comfortable in that one. Jumping right into these next two. You know, we had two ladies in the beginning. Now, actually, we're going to have a couple English fighters back to back here. So first off, we got number 7 with Jay Herbert. Now, what I really liked about his fight against Francisco Trinaldo is the excitement, right? That was such a back and forth fight in some ways, but he was actually dominating. I felt like even going into those later rounds, he was able to knock him down pretty badly, just couldn't get that finish. You know, Trinaldo, being the veteran that he is, just seems to hang in there as much as he possibly can. And he definitely did enough to come away with the finish there. Landed a big shot on Herbert that, you know, even looking bad at his previous career losses, he's only got 2 and they're both by finish. Norris McKee finished him off in Bama. And it's funny to think that those might be the only areas where, you know, keeping your hands up, making sure the cardio doesn't allow you to get a bit sloppy. Because, I mean, he trains with guys like, you know, he's good friends with Leon Edwards, comes out of a pretty, you know, big UK camp that's starting to make a, you know, a mark on the scene here in the UFC. So I think all the things are going right for him. And taking on a guy like Francisco Trinaldo is going to be nothing but, you know, win or lose, that's a learning experience, right? We kind of talked about in some of my previous videos of just how good Francisco Trinaldo has been in his career. And for Jay Herbert to get that under his belt so quickly is actually a huge, you know, feather in the cap for him, because it's going to set him up really well for these next fights. Because let's not even, you know, question how, who might have the toughest fight on this ranking. I mean, it's definitely Jay Herbert with taking on Renato Moicano, who's actually trying to make a, I guess, resurgence of a career in the lightweight division. And funny enough, his last fight against, you know, another Demir was, you know, Hadzevich, was actually a crazy good performance. And it even ended up so bad because, you know, Demir was expecting a striking game, took him to the ground, finished it, you know, pretty handedly. And there was even some back and forth after the fight. So, and for, you know, Jay Herbert to basically go from Francisco Trinaldo in his debut now to, you know, a guy like Renato Moicano, who's now not having to cut weight and make 155, pretty scary stuff. So I think that Jay Herbert, you know, again, win or lose, is going to be getting some of the best experience you can in the lightweight division with Trinaldo and Moicano. So, you know, again, if he pulls off a massive win here, which I think he should be an underdog, that's going to be a crazy, crazy performance. And it's going to obviously merit a much bigger fight for him. It's kind of insane that that fight is even on a prelim, but we'll get into that a little later on some of my other videos. But Jay Herbert, man, definitely an exciting striker, trains with Leon Edwards. I think he's got what it takes to kind of make a mark on the UFC, but when you're taking on guys like Francisco Trinaldo and a resurging Renato Moicano, it can probably be a little bit difficult than, say, for some other fighters. And, you know, we just brought up how it's going to be back-to-back English fighters. And so here we got Mason Jones. Mason Jones is a fighter that I got into pretty detailed on some of my other videos. So if you want to go check out my preview of UFC Vegas 28, that's already up now on Spotify as well. But Mason Jones, the Mike Davis fight, what a coming out party, right? He dominated the Cage Warriors arena in the UK, came out very, very, you know, hyped, I would say, from that. And he looked great. I mean, the thing with him is I wish he would keep his hands up a bit more. You know, that art of defense is something that there's certain fighters I just wish would do a bit more of that, because I think it would keep them even better in those later rounds. Because the one thing about him is even the commentators couldn't stop raving about just the heart, the grit, the ability to take damage and push forward. I mean, it was insane. And Mike Davis proved just how good his boxing was. But at the same time, such an experienced guy, Mason Jones put on a performance of his own. And the only thing that really, I would say, you know, we get into more details on this, but he was open a lot more on the left side, and that's something he might want to watch out for in his coming fight, because Mike Davis is mostly landing jabs and he clearly did a bunch of damage on that side of the face. But now you're going to be seeing some power shots from that side in a guy like Alan Patrick, right? I think Mason Jones is going to be a much better striker here. If it doesn't get to the ground where he's on his back trying to get up with a guy like Alan Patrick, you know, there should be, you know, room for him to really show what he can do at the UFC level. And I'm excited to see that, because one thing I can tell you right now is Mason Jones, win or lose, his fights are going to be crazy, crazy exciting. And he pushes a pace that very limited people can keep, even when they're taking damage. And that's what makes some of these guys crazy exciting. But again, if I'm going to be keeping the fight standing in the way that he does, I would just love to see a bit more defense in the boxing range, especially because, you know, Mike Davis was able to kind of land the right shots, because Mason Jones did quite a lot of damage of his own, but just Mike Davis looked like he was winning that fight. And that's what I really think swung the fight in his favor. And he just looked like such a good boxer. So obviously Mason Jones is going to get a bit of a breather when it comes to the stand-up game. I think that Mike, in comparison to Alan, are just going to be two different, you know, types of fighters there. But Mason should have the advantage in that arena, which should make this a very exciting fight based on what we've just witnessed from him. So keep an eye out for that one. I think in terms of transitions, he should still kind of have, you know, be able to stay on the feet and keep things kind of moving there. He should have a cardio advantage in those last few rounds. So expect an exciting fight if this doesn't end early. So I think that's a guy to really keep your eye on. And we only got him at number 6, but that takes us right into the top 5, right? I mean, Kanako Murata, that's got to be our number 5. She's probably one of the hottest, rising stars in the UFC right now in terms of female contenders. And, you know, in terms of strawweight champion and Invicta, and then transitioning over, taking on a veteran like Randa Marcos. Now, the thing about Randa Marcos even going into that fight, you would think that Murata was, you know, coming from that wrestling background and people just didn't know how good it was going to be in that fight. And I think she, not only for herself, but just single-handedly created crazy respect for Japanese wrestling, especially, you know, being all around MMA fighters coming into the UFC, because that was an area where people thought Randa Marcos might have a bit of an advantage, right? We thought that in terms of people she's fought, in terms of the transitioning that she's had to deal with on the ground, on the feet, in clinch work, she got overpowered. And one of the most impressive things about, you know, Murata's game there was just the distribution of weight. She really understood what to do with every sequence. And it's what rendered Marcos pretty much on her back for most of the fight. And the ground and pound damage that she was doing was really good. You kind of want to see more action from her, but again, we know now that the wrestling is the base and it's very, very effective, which is probably the best part of her game. And we all say it, right? Probably the best base to have in MMA is the wrestling. You can learn the rest of the stuff as you go, but being able to have that cardio that goes with being a wrestler, top game, being able to get back to your feet from being on the ground, those are the things that we really, really kind of, you know, hold dear to our hearts when it comes to, you know, cherishing that as the base, you know, martial art, if you will. So the one thing with Murata is when you look at the loss, Rin Nakai, big time, you know, MMA / you know, Japanese wrestling superstar. And her only two losses were Leslie Smith and Misha Tate. And she's destroying whatever arena she's in outside the UFC, but that's a pretty big deal. You know, you think about all the things that, you know, Murata is going to be able to bring to the table now with her experience. I think this is going to be huge for her. If that striking becomes more elite, she, you know, develops more of that athletic approach to the game. I think the conditioning, all those things that kind of now make champions in, you know, 2020, 2021 and beyond, that's probably the areas where we're going to see a lot more of improvement. You know, I think back to fighters like, look, Boom, you know, that's another great example where so much skill, so much technical prowess, and you know, even in terms of, you know, ring IQ, you know, octagon IQ, it's all there. And now it's about, you know, what do I need to change to get to that very top level? And I think she's starting to show that at that strawweight division. Now, funny enough, you know, Verna Jandiroba is going to be her opponent, where BJJ black belt, right? So that's an area where which one of these are really going to be able to dominate on the ground. I think that you're going to see Murata have some, you know, clinching ability and being able to get to the fence and maybe even to the ground, but that groundwork could be a little bit more active than Randa Marcos. And I think that's going to be a beautiful test to see just how good, you know, Murata can be on the ground in terms of, you know, keeping her position, transitioning into more opportune positions and even doing more damage on the ground. That's what I want to see more from, you know, because I think we can assume she's going to end up on top position for the most part in a lot of her fights if she's successful with her game plan. So being a little bit more deadly in that is something I'm really looking forward to. But I mean, I don't think there's a more exciting fighter to kind of keep an eye on when it comes to some of the female ranks, especially in the strawweight division. She's hella exciting, looks dominant, and, you know, one fight to go on. I think that's still pretty good, you know, experience to tag on. And like we said, a girl like Verna Jandiroba, talk about fights on the ground. The only people she's lost were Carla Sparza, who we are seeing have the best resurgence, maybe pound for pound in the UFC, 5-0 after, you know, beating Yan, who everyone was talking about being, you know, the next coming of Zhang Wei Li. But here we go. Mackenzie Dern is the next one. I mean, probably one of the best BJJ practitioners in the female rankings, if not, you know, approaching that pound for pound area based on some of the finishes she's pulling off. So that's where I'm seeing a lot of the growth from Murata coming into play. This is probably the fighter I've talked about the most right now, because you have to really consider just how good she's looked, the experience she's gained in her career so far, and the fact that now she's going to be able to, in just her second UFC fight, take on a fighter like Verna Jandiroba, who on the ground is beastly. You know, that's the best part about it. So get excited for that one. I don't think there's a better fight in terms of, you know, underground female MMA fights in the UFC to look forward to. I think that's going to be an absolute chess match when it comes to clinch work in the ground. And if you enjoy that stuff, like I do, like I'm sure Jeremy does, that's going to be fun. Now, the top four, I think the next two are personally interchangeable. I really had a tough time picking between the two. But the thing with Sean Woodson is that he lost. So with that, you know, fourth, you know, discrepancy with number three, I really think that he deserves to be at number four for now, only because that Julian Arosa fight, when you think about just how good he is as a boxer and how good he is on his feet in general, got those beautiful knees and uppercuts coming down the middle, that's an area where you want to see how good he is overall, because a guy like Julian Arosa, who's just such a gamer, I mean, that's the kind of guy that He's got skills everywhere, but you got to put him away, because if you don't put away a guy like Julian Arosa, and it's funny, I'm talking pretty similarly about a guy like Mason Jones, because they're able to keep pushing that pace. Give them all the damage in the world. They seem to, you know, have a health bar in video games. It seems like there's certain fighters where their health bar, the more damage they take, they kind of wake up. And you see growth there. It's like a superpower. Everyone has a little bit of a superpower in MMA, in my opinion. And that could be the same thing for those brawler styles, because that late submission win for Julian Arosa, I mean, he's a personal favorite. I was on my feet going crazy. I got to say that, to be honest, but I love what I see from Sean Woodson on the feet. I think his jab is crisp as hell. He's got great 1-2s, beautiful combos that involve his legs. And even his work up against the fence, I mean, he's not taken down as much. You know, when you think back to the Bochniak fight, that was just the one. I touch on him a lot more in a video. So once again, coming into this weekend, if you want to go check out UFC Vegas 28, sorry, videos are going to be up. I think that that's a guy that really is going to shine when it comes to, you know, exciting fights, because the boxing is just so good. I think it's 40 amateur boxing fights he's got under his belt. So we've seen that in all the times that he's been in the octagon. And it's just about wearing from that grappling, wrestling background. Like, that's just where, you know, if you're going to perfect your craft, those are the areas you got to work on. And again, I was just about to say, with the Bochniak fight, he stuffed like 14 or 15 of 15 or 16 takedowns. So literally got taken down once of 15 or 16 times. And that's going to build confidence, especially when you're a guy like Woodson, who's consistently working on his game. He trains with guys out in James Krause's camp, the Glory Kickboxing and Fitness, or sorry, the Glory Fitness Training Center with James Krause. And that's a growing camp, right? That's where Laura Sanko and Julian Marquez and some of the bigger names are coming out. So I really like what we're seeing from Sean Woodson. I think that he's in the perfect place for him to really work on, you know, the transitioning from the clinches and getting back to his feet and staying off the fence, all that stuff. Because if the fight stays in the middle and he's able to fight long, I think he's a dangerous fight for absolutely anybody. And, you know, if he can't put guys like Julian Arosa away, that's another thing to kind of keep in mind, be mindful and disciplined with some of that clinch and groundwork, where you can probably get trapped in a submission if you're not too careful. But outside of that one slip up, I mean, the guy's an absolute beast. And again, keep an eye out for that boxing, because it might be, you know, shaking some heads come the next 6 to 12 months. And with a big win this coming weekend, I think it's going to be, you know, one of the guys to keep an eye on overall in that weight class. And that takes us right into the next one, right? Top three. Here we go. Jordan Levitt. Jordan Levitt's one of those guys where I just don't keep preaching about how funny his topology picture is and gangster that looks. But, you know, he's a real calm, cool, collected type of fighter, right? The Monkey King himself. I mean, he really does remind me of a monk. Again, we get into him in quite a lot of detail. UFC Vegas 28 videos. Go check them out on the Suki MMA page. But I really do think that this is a guy that he's going to have to face that really tough competition and being able to see just how good he is, especially in the early rounds. Because the one thing that I did see in terms of just overall experience, you know, getting into those later rounds, that's where he's probably going to get tested the most. You know, he seems to do a lot of great work in the first and second rounds. But if you're a fighter that can avoid some of that damage and take it to that third round, funny enough, going into his opponent, he's that type of fighter, right? He's the kind of guy that takes crazy amounts of damage, you know. And Poyas, he's an absolute beast, you know, in the third rounds. Blocks up submissions absolutely out of nowhere after taking so much damage. So it's going to be a beautiful test for Jordan Levitt. I do think that he's going to be better on the feet. So he has the advantage on the feet, and he has a ground game that he's so confident, where I think that in this case, unless he notices that he's not being as successful as he wants to be on the feet, he can then choose to take it on the ground and just see how good Poyas' ground game is. But all in all, you know, this is, I guess, considered Jordan Levitt's fight to lose. But again, Poyas is such a, you know, young prospect in the UFC who hasn't just fought that much. So there's a lot of opposites with these two. But I mean, in terms of getting that big win, I think both guys have an opportunity here to really showcase something big. Because if Poyas is able to slow down a guy like Jordan Levitt, who's looking so exciting, and even personality-wise, like, these are the guys that tend to get the right fights, because he can showcase skill and personality at the same time. So, you know, I think he's the kind of guy everybody wants to root for. But Poyas has the opportunity, you know, spoiler there. And again, if this fight does go to the ground, I think that's where Jordan Levitt's going to be able to test just how good his grappling and submission game really is. But on the feet, let's see how good that's been getting. Very late to MMA, I think that's what makes him, you know, a question mark across the board. But his performances so far, especially having fought in the UFC already, is what makes him, you know, such a fun and highly touted prospect going into the month. So we're going to keep him at number three and hope that, you know, he maintains a pretty good showing for us. But going into numbers one and two, I mean, number two and number one, probably over one. Number one is one of my favorite fighters that are coming out of nowhere here. We'll get into him shortly, but number two, Tagir Ulanbekov. I mean, there isn't a flyweight that's just like on the cusp of really proving something than him. I mean, this is another Dagestani trained by Abdulmanap Nurmagomedov. These guys are the ones we get excited to see all the time, right? The little Khabibs. And for me, he's like one or two fights away from really starting to see some of the big boys in the flyweight division, right? He's coming out of, guerrilla fighting as their undisputed flyweight champion. He actually won it and defended it a few times before coming into the UFC and already beaten guys like Bruno Silva. But go even before that, he actually fought one of my other favorite fighters here, but Zalgat Zhumagulov, I mean, that fight, that's his only loss on his record. But if you go watch that fight is actually available on YouTube. So by all means, feel free to go and watch that entire fight. But I would be shocked if that fight was in the UFC if it did not go Ulanbekov's way. Because I was really surprised to see that the judges, in a majority decision, gave it to Zalgat Zhumagulov, who then became, you know, the champion of that organization. So funny enough, you know, Ulanbekov went from what could have been a championship win in one organization to then literally the next fight after fighting Zalgas was for the Guerrilla FC belt, which he then defended a few times and now is coming into the UFC. So I don't think there's a guy to get more excited about. This is going to be one of those, you know, little Islam Makhachev, little Khabib Nurmagomedovs. I think that's like the key to the puzzle there from the lower weight classes, because he just looks hella exciting. The boxing's there. And obviously we know that these guys love to wrestle. They have that background in it, but great jab, little things like that, right? We've seen them all kind of showcase those skills. And I think that's what makes it the most fun in terms of just seeing how good they're becoming in terms of boxing and wrestling, because we always just used to hear about the Dagestani wrestlers, but man, some of the striking and boxing is just looking so good. And again, that's coming right from the Khabib, you know, man himself. I really do think he has, you know, a pretty good chance of winning his next fight. I don't think that, you know, we can even count that one loss as a loss. And if the UFC is willing to book that rematch, what a great fight that would be. But I think Zhumagulov has some of his own, you know, issues to work out in terms of, you know, his current UFC record and things like that. But look out for Ulanbekov to really take things by storm in 2021. I think the flyweight division itself is just on such a rise with guys like Brandon Royval, Brandon Moreno, who I've been preaching about for so long. And I'm so happy that he's about to get that rematch, because, man, I thought people were just counting him out. Vegas odds on that fight, I don't think there's a fight that stands worse in my head, because it's not like you can just bet him and hope that he wins. But like, that was very, very one-sided in my opinion. And I just think that, wow, you have not watched Brandon Moreno fight. So with that said, flyweight division is basically on fire right now. Guys like Tagir Ulanbekov are on the rise in the division. So I'm really excited to see what he can do come, you know, end of June and beyond, because I don't think there's a guy that you want to keep your eye on if you're a big Khabib fan and love those Dagestani wrestlers. Now, I think that's enough about Tagir. You can go watch that Zalgas fight if that's up your alley, because I think he won that fight. Now, for number one, Shavkat Rakhmonov. I mean, anytime he comes up, I'm going crazy. You know, I am definitely falling for this man. I think he's a phenomenal fighter, exciting. I'm going to say that it's a little biased, because even when I watch him fight, not only does it always look like that Japanese type of arena and things like that, but man, the guy just reminds me so much of Kazushi Sakuraba. And I'm going to say it every time he comes up, but you know, the way he fights, he's just gritty and violent and willing to take it anywhere. Like if you think about the fight, you know, against Cowboy Oliveira, he was getting hit, you know, but he kept pushing forward. I think he had a lot of confidence when it got technical. He was willing to take anything that Cowboy threw. I don't think he was, you know, fazed by any of it. And then that knee to the body that he threw up against the fence. Ugh, you know, it's so interesting to see how good striking can be for certain people when it looks like they're brawling, but then they land the most perfect technical shot in the moment, you know? It's like when you think about a batter in baseball having to actually decide where the hell he wants to hit the ball when it's coming at 99 miles per hour in a fastball. So it's little things like that. How quick the brain needs to be to do that, because I think that fight would have been hella competitive. Maybe one of Shavkat's toughest fights to date. You know, he also was coming into the UFC as an ex-champion. And I mean, I think in that fight, if he did not have that presence of mind to land such a big shot, who knows how tough that fight would have been. But you can't say that because literally, knee to the body, Cowboy looks hurt from that point on. And you know him, right? He's just going to keep giving it his all if he can stand. But slowly but surely, twists it around, tries to go for a takedown up against the cage, and Shavkat just grabs the neck and locks up it wasn't a standing guillotine. He actually locks it up while he's standing and then drops to, you know, into his guard and locks it in so clean. I mean, it was beautiful. And that's why, you know, I got to say, for a guy that not only reminds me of probably my GOAT in terms of all fighters of all time, that's a very interesting fighter to keep an eye on, you know, training out of Sanford MMA now. And, you know, he's like really good friends with Rafael Fiziev, who, you know, if you're an Instagram guy, there isn't a better fighter to follow than Rafael Fiziev. If you love these Russian fighters and actually want someone that's speaking English regularly and making jokes regularly, and I mean, right now he's actually pranking Shavkat Rakhmonov quite a bit. So go check those boys out, because I don't think there's two guys that are more deadly in the octagon, but also seem to be hella fun to keep an eye on. And like I said, training out of Sanford MMA, it's a big move for the both of them. I think that if there's any two fighters to keep your eye on, it's those two guys coming out of the Sanford and really representing a huge crop of not just the Dagestani type of fighters, but just Russian, Kazakhstan, all these different places. You know, it's a huge influx, and they're deadly, man. They're just good everywhere, and they just don't seem afraid of any type of fight. Peter Yan, my God, I can watch that guy fight for hours. Same reasons, right? So that's the top 10. We ended off with Shavkat Rakhmonov. You know, going through this list, I don't think I've been more excited about a top two fight. And I mean, I'm crossing my fingers, right? Like, I don't want the Ulanbekov or the Rakhmonov fight to, you know, be dropped for any reason. But then we go down the list, you know, Woodson's such a great striker. You know, if he's able to keep the fight standing and land at will, just violence. That's going to be bloody as hell. Jordan Levitt, calm, cool, collected man, coming in at number three. I think those two are definitely interchangeable, but three ladies on this card, two of them fighting each other. That's going to be the most exciting, right? Murata, let's see what she can do against a girl like Verna, who's definitely going to test that grappling with her BJJ black belt. But, you know, two guys from the UK with Jay Herbert and Mason Jones, you know, best of luck to both of them. And last and certainly not least, you know, Casey O'Neill and Lara Procopio. I think those are going to be the two girls that really, you know, with a big win are going to be able to get probably into that top 15, because it seems like we need some fresh faces just to get excited about. And I know for sure that Casey O'Neill is someone they're trying to get pretty high on. So that's the 10 for June. I mean, let's hope that it stands pretty good as opposed to maybe what happened in April. But always a pleasure. Till next month, looking forward to it. Peace.